what Kahan said. I agree. I want to take something back. I'm sorry. It says you're not the first one that I've seen polygamy work on. I take that back. The Middle East people, a lot of them come from, you know, Arabic, and they come from polygamists. And they, and a lot of people I grew up with would tell me, oh, I had like three moms. Everything went great. It was wonderful. We lived in a, so I think it's a Western thing. I think, you know, the me thing, the selfish thing. And I think, like I said before, it would take a really strong woman to know who she is in herself and God and who she is, where there's no envy, there's no strife. And then also with the man that he doesn't show favoritism, right? Because we did it on the other side, right? We did right, guys? We did an interview where, so that man, but you know, it gets, if the woman, if the person, if someone's heart is messed up in that, it'll throw it all off.
Jacob showed favoritism. You realize that, right?
Oh, yeah.
Jacob loved Maria. I mean, Rachel.
Because remember, he wanted her first, and then the dad gave him. That's true.
He said, yo, you can't get the oldest one first. It's uncustomary.
That's true.
So, yeah, I mean, that, and, you know, like, and that causes, it caused, they kept competing against that.
Right. I didn't think about that.
And when she couldn't, when she couldn't get pregnant anymore, she said, here, take my handmaid. And so now he married her. That's how he ended up with four wives. Like, see, and this is what I tell people all of the time. Two of the wives that the nation of Israel was built off of wasn't even Israelites. They were Hamites. They were Africans. Because they was two handmaids, two slave women that belonged to their two wives.
Man. Khan. I didn't even think of that.
Yep.
Let me write that down.
Rachel, Leah, be dropping gems. Bill and Zilpah. Khan.
Mm-hmm. Khan.
You'll be pulling out the gems, Khan. I agree. I like this cop topic because I think a lot of people do judge polygamy based off of like the show Sister Wives because they all broke up and Cody.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Look at Cody. I mean, who would they? That's different. You know, that's a, but from this sister's perspective, I would really love to hear more. I love it. Do you guys not, I don't want to get too nosy, but do you guys all live together in the same household? How does that work with the children? You know, what are the benefits like with the children growing up? Because I'm really interested in that. You know, raising children together and y'all sister wise spending time. I think that's great that you got a sister there. It would you know, I would have to have a team of sisters that I would think to support because I think the reason why it doesn't work for most women, especially if they're like worldly, is because there's envy there, there's strife, like y'all said, there's competition, and it's just like no one's really loving each other. Like true love and unity, you know, and want the best to build each other up. So Do you ladies, I mean, do you all live together? How do you guys make this work with the children? Do you ever feel like each child gets enough time with the dad, with the father? Because let's face it, fathers are important. Is that ever a concern with any of you in here that have children and are in polygamy? Do you ever feel like one of my children will lack? These are questions that I'm really asking to learn.
No, not at all. The thing is too, again, as with everything else, it's like if there is an issue, then absolutely you bring it up, you know, and you say, hey, what happened or what's caused you to feel this way? Or where is that coming from?
Go ahead, sis. I was just telling him to get a preset on that. I'm going to bring something up. Go ahead, sis.
So it's just a matter of, you know, if there is an issue, then let me present that issue, because sometimes you may feel that way. You may feel that, hey, wait, this is like, you know, not fair, because it is very true as far as you want things to be consistent, you know. And it just depends too on personal needs as well, because sometimes what one child may need, the other one may not, or even one wife, the other one may not. We were talking earlier, and some people say, oh, you can't compare it, but to me, you can. I do. It's no different than children, right? As far as my perspective, and that's all I'm speaking on. As far as children, I literally love my children, all three the same. I don't love one more than the other at all. You know, those are my babies, you know what I'm saying? And I'll kill behind my babies. Love them. However, I am very aware of their personalities, what works for them, how they function. So I know that, you know, I can get a little rowdy with one, the other one will be like, ah, you know, so I know.
That's the youngest one.
Yes. And, you know, so you can't sit here and think you're going to do the same thing for all of them because they're three different people. They have different love languages. They have three different styles of communication because they're just different. And it's no different than with wives. You know, what may work for me ain't gonna work for her. She don't like that. I do. You see what I'm saying? But you have to have the emotional intelligence and you have to know your woman at the end of the day. You know, so sometimes I feel sorry for the brothers because that's a lot you got to keep up with, okay? Because I only got to worry about me and you. But, you know, it's one of those things that you have to know that. You have to know. And if I do feel that you're giving her something that you're not giving me, that I feel that, let me say it like this. Again, I always want for her what I want for myself. That woman deserves her shine and her moment and whatever that connection is y'all have with each other. However, if I do feel that something is not consistent or not fair, I bring it up. You know, and I've even said to them, do y'all think I'm tripping? You know, and I'll say my piece and how I feel. You know, and that's the thing. I'm in a safe space and I should be. You see what I'm saying? Even if I'm feeling, I should be able to be vulnerable and say, hey, I ain't like that. It's making me feel some type of way. And I have. And I'll be like, no, you was getting a little bit extra and I didn't get that. And I'm not hating on you. However, the same thing you want, I want that too.
Can I ask you this? How do you feel does your husband, how does he react to that? Like, how does he maneuver this? I would like to see, like, what are some of the positives, right? Give us the positives that you feel how he handles all of you. Because it's three of you guys, women, right?
Yes. Yes,
it's like it's my second. What was that precept you asked me for?
Oh, sorry.
Titus 2:5. Hey, I just wanted to address something Moshe said, because we want to stay in the spirit. So we do this over here, we do this biblically, right? So not worldly, but based off of emotion. So let's get, because she said it's about the children. Let's see what the Most High say. Hey, Yashabim, read that Bereshit 3:16.
Call on the book of Bereshith, Genesis chapter 3, verse 16. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over
thy children. To your children.
To thy husband.
To their children.
To thy husband.
To their children.
Thy desire shall be to thy husband.
Okay, so that's the Lord of Most High gave us. Get that Titus 2, verse 5. This is what the Most High says. But, and this is what things typically don't work out. Let me say this. Let me say this before you read up. One mistake a lot of women make is they want to control a child's life, right? But children grow up and they want to have their own lives. When a child get a certain age, that child is going to have his own life. It's going to start to want to make his own decisions, right? And a lot of women, and this is why we have so many mother's boys, right? Or you have women that can't get married because their mothers is still holding on to them and won't let them grow and be themselves. So their lives end up getting ruined.
That is true.
Yeah, their lives end up getting ruined. Because it's a mother's girl. Like, I knew one woman that couldn't move with her husband because she didn't want to leave her mother.
That's crazy.
What that's what the Most High put these things here. Titus 2, verse 5. Huh?
Come on. The book of Titus, chapter 2, verse 5. To be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of Yahuwah be not blasphemed.
So the scriptures say when a woman is disobedient to her husband, it's like blaspheming the Holy Spirit. That's what it just said. It's like blaspheming the Holy Spirit. All right,
yes,
go ahead.
Yes. Back to that. Because it's not representing the Most High in the right light.
So, you know, I'm kind of a different father and people don't understand it. Like, let me give an example. So, like, I don't like dealing with the court system, first of all, right? And so I have legal custody, though, right? I have, like, the kind of legal custody that the mother only get to see them when I decide that is okay, right? But I don't play those kind of games. I believe when she want to see him, take the children, right? So some, you know, unexpectedly, for some reason, when Yeshaya went to stay with his mother last summer, I let him go there for the summer, right? He, after he was around her for a little bit, he's saying, "Dad, I want to stay over here." And so, you know me, I don't like to manipulate their thinking. I want them to be able to make positive thoughts. So, but I also don't, you know, I don't make thoughts on my own. First thing I do is pray. Then I get other perspectives. So I talk to Kadar about it. I talk to Eric about it. And, you know, they kind of, "Nah, I don't think you should let him go. I don't think you should let him stay. He needs to be under his father." I said, "Well, I believe in letting people learn on their own. So I appreciate your perspective, but I'm going to let him stay over there because he needs to learn the hard way." Eric said, "Nah, Tyler, Doc, don't do it." I said, "No, he needs to learn. Oh, that's what he think he wants." And so he can't blame nobody for that but him. But I told him and I told her, non-emotional. I said, "I don't agree with this. I believe that you kind of like conspired to him and you influenced his thinking. Though I don't agree with it, since he believes that's where he wants, I'm going to let him stay there. He can stay there. He's going to stay there." Well, so he saw it stand there. Now, all of a sudden, when he used to live with his mother, he had this problem throwing up consistently. I don't know what it is. A few days after he got there again, his skin started to break out really bad. He started throwing up again. He had to leave in school because he kept, and mind you, she don't keep the cleanest house. He had to leave in school because he kept throwing up. So I try and bring to his attention, and her supposedly husband at the time, the guy reached out to me telling me these things. Like, "Yo, I don't know what's up with Yeshaya, but he's been staying up real late on the computer. I hear him in the back room. He's cursing, saying, 'I knock niggas like you out.' Like, what kind of stuff?" I said, "Yeah, he never done that. He can't do that in my crib. That's not going to happen. Yeah, he ain't going to do that in my crib, man." So the guy's telling me more. The guy said, "Yeah, she leaves her work at 6 and don't get home until like 10 at night." So I said, so he basically watching himself. Then the guy told me the first week that he was there, he just disappeared and went out and stayed somewhere for like 4 days. So I was like, so she's really not watching him. So I'm jotting this down in my memory bank. So I let it ride out. Then I start to get like, I homeschooled them, right? They're not in the public school. I homeschool them. Goes down there. She don't have time to watch. She throw him back in the public school. He thinks that's what he wants, right? So I knew he was capping. He was telling me, "I want to go to school so I could play sports and all of that." A couple months passed. I said, "Yo, you sign up for the football team?" "Nah, it's too late. I can't get a physical." I said, "Well, track season's coming up. You can run track. You're fast." I ran track. I went to state. You know what I mean? He said, I don't. So start studying. I said, "I thought you wanted to go back to school to play sports." So he capped on that. Now the guy, and Kadar could attest to this, because he was on the phone a lot of times when I talked to this guy that was her husband. So the guy's telling us all of this stuff, how she keeps a nasty house, and she falls asleep, leave the stove on, and he has to turn it off. Yeah, some just real reckless stuff, same way she was when she was with me. So now I'm getting all of these messages from the school. "Shia didn't go to school today." I mean, so long story short, he was roughly only there for about 3 months before I told him, "You need to come back," because he missed almost like 4 weeks out of school in only 3 months. So I told her, "You're going to get charged with truancy." And check out how she took him to the Bronx, dropped him off at her mom's for a week and a half while she took vacation to Africa. And he missed all of those days of school. So it's like, when you get back, you need to bring him back. Need to bring him back. But it was a hard lesson. And so that's what I mean about, you know, trying to govern someone's life based off emotions. See, she knew that she can't raise him. He's taller than her now. But the man was telling me he doesn't even respect her. Like, she tell him to do something, he won't do it. You know what I mean? I'm gonna tell you once, man. You understand? I'm gonna tell you once. Uh-huh. Then I'm gonna have to guide you there, if you understand what I'm saying. I'm going to take you there. And we think you're bigger than me, buddy. It's time to go. No emotions attached. I don't care if it's a son, whatever. He disrespects me, he's gone. because that's how I was raised, man. Mm-hmm. That's how I was raised. When you think you're too big for me, you gotta go. That's what my family told me. That's what my dad told me, man. My dad told me, boy, you getting kind of big now. I see you hitting those weights. He took me outside and he showed me his bunner. Don't you think you get too big for this, boy? That's what he told me. I just started laughing. I said, yeah, I feel you. I feel you. We good? He said, you sure? I said, yeah, we good. Wow.